everyone, and welcome to HOA Fight Club. Today I wanted to do a video on the history of HOAs and how they kind of came into formation. The first HOA was in New York in the 1940s. It was a result of the federal government's encouragement of having more communities in smaller areas so that they could build outside of the cities and have a way for the people to go, you know, to a cheaper place to get a home. Well, the cheaper place, I don't think really kind of stayed that way. But because they were so popular, it restored and increased the cost of land. In the real estate, developers started buying this land because they knew that this was going to be the only way and there was going to be a big boom for housing in these areas. So if there's more homes on a piece of land, they ended up subdividing it into smaller places. I think the homes used to come on these big lands, and you know, they didn't want to do that anymore because of part of the problem was the clean water. You know, they weren't getting water and hookups and all that kind of stuff. So the developers really took advantage of this and started buying the land so that they could develop on it and have these communities in it. Well, then they were also given the power to take away the people's public rights of the municipality, and which is totally unconstitutional in Washington state, but you can't give a public situation to a private enterprise, which is what they really, really did with HOA. They gave away all of our public rights into and give it to private people to write the laws for us. So associations were to manage the green space around each one of these areas, which is the common areas. They weren't supposed to manage the people. They were just supposed to manage the green space so that you could have a community built around a park, and they shared that park so that it wasn't as expensive as having your own, you know, pool and workout rooms. So those cabanas and everything, those became really popular because people could share the expenses of those things, not realizing that when they did get into these HOAs, that the developers had the right to fine you and foreclose for those fines and foreclose for everything else. Let's look at the stats of HOA. So the stats is over 70 million U.S. residents live in an association of some sort. There are over 342,000 communities in the United States, and there's 5,000 new communities being built every year. So in 2016, approximately $5.5 trillion of real estate was under HOA management. Wow. 18% of all housing is under HOA management. The HOA industry brings in an estimated annual revenue of over $88 billion. This guarantees that the HOA industry will flourish. Well, of course it'll flourish because these are the same people that are making the laws for HOA, the legislation and that. So this is why a trades group benefiting from the demise of homeowners should not be creating laws that violate and ignore the constitutional rights of our citizens. So CAI was created by themselves. They decided that these attorneys and property managers were going to get together and form this trades group that was going to monitor the HOA industry. They appointed themselves. This wasn't a government appointed thing, but they appointed themselves to do this. Management companies boast that HOA will ensure that properties will be taken care of, maintained uniformity, and remain a pleasant place to live. Well, I can tell you that's not true. I don't know how they boast that they can ensure that when there's no insurance that it's going to keep your property values up. In fact, there's no proof or evidence that an HOA or property management company will keep your property values high. There's no guarantees that they'll take care of the property, which 99% I probably are not taking care of. I'm sure there's huge issues, especially in condo association. There are huge issues, and they don't have to follow their CC&Rs. Our CC&Rs demanded that they restored right away. Well, they can deny, delay, and deflect all of that as long as they want. And even if they do get insurance money for your property, they don't have to spend it on your property. So how is that taking care of our property values? So they are saying that the property values are increased because we have all these rec centers and everything else. But I know rec centers and pools that are closed that have never been opened in an HOA, but the HOA is still charging the homeowners for the maintenance of those things. So I don't think they can guarantee anything, which is what they're trying to do. So the real estate developers, they get to make the laws, they create the CC&Rs, all states have different laws. So if you go from one state to another, the laws completely change and you may not have, you probably will have less rights than what you do right now. And the passage of the Davis-Sterling Interest Development Act in 1985 is what they've based all of this on. So CAI was created in 1973. It is sought to be the people's, the people that build and service common developments in order to become a significant force in the interest groups of politics. So CAI is not out there for the homeowner, and it's really not out there for the homeowners association. They are out there to make sure that their property managers and their attorneys and their builders and everybody else, the insurance companies, all profit in this way together as a group. So you have this huge group that really has no stake in HOA except for what they're profiting from us. I know construction companies that are CAI construction companies that only do HOA stuff because they get paid no matter what. They have these multi-million dollar funds they're dealing with. And so it's really, really a very, I call it the mob type, you know, atmosphere with the CAI and the property managers and attorneys and everything. According to Evan McKenzie, which is, he's an author, they are dominated by lawyers and property managers. And they have shaped legislation and judicial policy making regulations of CID activity to keep the discourse on such matters largely private. So if they don't ever have to go to court because they can keep it in their private little entity, that's what they do. So now, when you go to court right now, you go to civil court. CAI is actually trying to come up with a alternative dispute resolution program that they will control. Now, CAI is a private trades group corporation. They do what's best for their members. They don't do what's best for the associations. They don't do what's best for the board. They do what's best for its members. Well, if the majority of its members are property managers and attorneys, well, then that's who they are making those laws for. So they're not doing the laws to protect homeowners and the association. They're doing the laws to protect those property managers and attorneys. That is one reason why attorneys can charge whatever they want. That's why attorneys don't have to follow the fair collection laws. This is why those same attorneys don't have to defend your constitutional rights. They can ignore the Constitution if you live in an HOA, and they do it all the time. So my question is, what gives the government the right to give away the public interest to a private group? So they've given away everything, all of your rights, to a private group, and then there's no accountability, governance, or anything to make sure that these corporations are running correctly. So local governments want to have HOAs. They want to have no responsibility. They don't want to have to worry about the roads and the water and the sewers and the gas lines. So this is a great way to do it, is by giving it to the developer, then the developer charges all the homeowners. Well, the Clean Water Act of 1977 makes it so that these people are supposed to they required the communities to take care of the retention ponds and make sure they build them correctly and have the water flowing going the right way. So if you have water intrusion problems on your property, I would suggest you check out the Clean Water Act of 1977 and make sure that your association is following those federal guidelines. Because if they're not, they are responsible for that. So that's something that I just learned, and that's a federal act. So now the municipality has no responsibility. They don't have to worry about you, which is unconstitutional. CAI represents the interest of its members, and remember, they're dominated by attorneys and PMs. CAI does not represent the Homeowners Association. It lobbies to promote legislation beneficial to its members and opposes any law that would harm them. So you have to remember that as you're going through all the HOA laws, and when you start questioning CAI. I question CAI all the time. I'd love to get in a room with them and talk with them, because I think that they either are very misinformed or they just don't care about the homeowners, which with my experience, they don't. When any attorney will advocate the right to take away your 14th and 6th Amendment rights, there's an issue because they don't think they have to follow the Constitution, and the Constitution should apply to all. All right, you guys, there's that one for today. I'll see you on the next one.